that phrase and that call of the Lord on the disciples, and we covered how they did that literally, and that had to do with the miracle ministry of Jesus and the kingdom ministry of Jesus. Last week we dealt with Jesus being confrontational, which hopefully dispelled the myth of the gentle Jesus, meek and mild. I failed to sing to you. I was planning on singing to you Away in a Manger last week, but if you sing that song in your head, you come away thinking, well, Jesus was just a quiet little baby. You know, when actually you read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and he's anything but a quiet little baby. He's a full-grown man, and he's very confrontational. And so we studied last week how Jesus wasn't a very good dinner guest when his dinner guests had sins, which isn't how you practice your dinner hosting nowadays, but that's what Jesus did. He had a ministry to do, and he performed it, and he was very confrontational. And so a lot of people think that that's not how we ought to minister. We need to be like Jesus was. Well, Jesus did confront people, and he was outspoken that way. And this week, I want to deal with the hard sayings of Jesus. Okay, many people picture Jesus, like Warner Solomon, the Church of God in Anderson, Indiana, painted the picture of Jesus with the children on his lap. And they think, well, Jesus called little children to him. And Jesus loves little children, as you sing in Sunday school, right? And so Jesus' teachings must have been as simple as a child to learn. In fact, Jesus said, if you're going to enter the kingdom of heaven, you got to humble yourself like a child, which has nothing to do with what you know, which we've covered before. It has to do with your humility. But meanwhile, people picture Jesus as ministering to children and conclude that he must teach very simple lessons, very clear lessons, as you would to a child. And he does so with tolerance and that sort of thing. And so we covered last week the confrontational nature of Jesus, but this week I want to deal with some very hard things that Jesus said. Hard things that he said at the time that he ministered, which a lot of times made his ministry too difficult for people. It made his ministry something that people avoided, because what he said was hard to swallow, it was hard to accept. But not only that, but if people actually heard what Jesus said, they may not even recognize it as being something Jesus said, because they don't read those portions of Jesus' ministry that he said some very hard things. Hard to understand and hard to swallow. So we'll be dealing with that this morning. Many people think that Jesus is just a divine fortune cookie. You know the phrase, do unto others as you'd want them to do unto you, right? The phrase is not in your Bible. Matthew 7, 12 is the closest place it comes where Jesus does it very differently. So this is just one example. The phrase, do unto others, which is what people often quote, actually comes from the Catholic Catechism. Okay, and they paraphrased Matthew chapter 7 down in verse 12, where Jesus said, therefore, all things whatsoever ye would that men should do to you, do ye even so to them, for this is the law and the prophets. It doesn't have the same ring, roll off the tongue, does it, do unto others. But we have Jesus saying that, which just in the nature of it is a little more difficult than do unto others. But, you know, Jesus is not just a divine fortune cookie. You know, Confucius actually said it better when he says, do not unto others what you would not have them do to you. And so that is actually closer to the way you would say it. But he's not just wise saying. So you picture pulling Jesus' string, and he says some platitude that you memorize, and it's good for living. Jesus actually said some very hard things, some things that required study, required knowledge. And so that's why he said over and over again, if you have ears to hear, let them hear. The idea of having ears to hear is that you know God's word. You've studied the prophets. You've studied the law. You know what to expect and what should be happening. You can discern the times, as Jesus said, and you're able to do that. The simple, those who ignored God's word, those who did not understand things, they're the ones that missed it. Okay, and so there are some very hard things that Jesus did. And as we're studying how Jesus ministered, this may be contrary, and we'll see that it is contrary, to the way that we minister today. We've been given a very simple message of salvation. Grace of God is simple. The preaching of the cross is simple. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 2:2, I knew nothing among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. Very simple. You're the sinner. Christ died to pay for your sins. He resurrected to give you eternal life. Very simple. But that is not the ministry of Jesus and his earthly ministry to Israel. Okay, and so when we're analyzing how he ministered to them, we see it could be very different. There are many hard sayings of Jesus, not the least of which were his parables, which we'll cover shortly, which had to do with him confusing people. Jesus intentionally kept things secret, hid things from people, made them complex, and did not want people to understand some things. Again, this does not sound like the pattern of the ministry of the church, the body of Christ, when God's revealed will has been given to us, and we're to make people see things. What we see in Jesus' ministry, he had a specific role to play. We would be wrong then to pattern ourselves, to pattern our ministry after what Jesus did. There's lots of things that he did and said that we would not do and say. There's lots of things that he did and said that we could not do and say because we're not God. Okay, and we'll see some of those things today. So look at John chapter 2. Jesus was very confrontational his approach, but sometimes even his words were hard. And you have to consider, as we consider first the hard things Jesus said to Israel, the hard things that he said 2,000 years ago, put yourself in their shoes, in that context. We're here talking about a time when God was operating through a nation, through a covenant. He was not operating through the church, which did not exist yet. He was not preaching the gospel of the grace of God, which had not been revealed yet. And you as a Gentile weren't even in the same locale that Jesus was ministering. John 1, Jesus came to his own, people Israel. He was a minister to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, Matthew 15 says. But John 2, verse 19, look what he says here about the temple, which if anything, Israel had that they could boast in, it would be their temple. This temple that was built, this huge structure, this glorious structure, gold and silver, everything else inside of it, this religious system that by far was the most magnanimous religious system in the world at the time, it's what gave Solomon's kingdom its glory, was this temple. Okay? But in John 2, verse 19, Jesus said unto them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. That's what he says. Now, this is not just the first sentence of a sermon by the Lord. Jesus stops with that. And you know that because no one understood what he said. The next verse says, there were Jews, and they said, 46 years was this temple in building, and wilt thou rear it up in 3 days? They thought he was talking about the literal building of the temple, the literal tearing down of the temple. By the way, his threats to tear down the temple was part of what people didn't like about what he said. Okay, but he said, I'll build it in 3 days. I'll raise it up in 3 days. Now, in verse 21, it says he spake of the temple of his body. But you know what? No one knew that. Not even his disciples. Okay, you read now in the book of John how in verse 22, when therefore he was risen from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said unto them, and they believed the scripture and the word which Jesus had said. But they didn't know at the time. So here's Jesus, and we're studying how he ministered. The only record we have is Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And we read in John 2 what Jesus said was, destroy this temple, and 3 days I'll raise it up. And the Jews are going, it's impossible. And the disciples are going, he's the Lord. You know, whatever he says, it's a hard thing, but they didn't get it. Right? If I said, destroy this city, and I'll build it again in 3 days, you'll think I'm nuts. It's a hard saying. You see what I'm saying? He said things are very difficult. Now, of course, they looked back after his resurrection and said, oh, that's what it meant. But when he ministered, how he ministered was very hard. Look at John 20. His disciples didn't even know what he was talking about when they saw the empty tomb, as we've covered in our verse-by-verse through the book of John. In John 20, verse 8, when they saw the empty tomb, Mary Magdalene was the first person to see the stone rolled away. She looked in, saw that it was empty, and said they stole the body. And that's what John 20, verse 1 and 2 talks about. And down in verse 8, here comes John and Peter, and they run to the sepulcher. They see the empty tomb. They see the clothes wrapped around. And when they went in also, that other disciple, which is John, which came first to the sepulcher, he saw and believed. And the question you ought to ask is, what did he believe? He believed Mary Magdalene's testimony that someone stole the body. So even at this point, when the stone was rolled away, they didn't rejoice to the Lord he was resurrected. They hadn't seen him yet. They didn't understand it. For as yet they knew not the scripture that he must raise again from the dead. John 20, verse 9. Okay? So there's things that Jesus said in his ministry concerning his resurrection, concerning the things that he would do that just were impossible. No one had seen these things before. Okay? Raising the temple in 3 days. Look at John chapter 10, verse 33. Jesus acted and spoke like God. Now we know, now, reading the book of John as proves that Jesus is the Son of God, and reading Paul's epistles in Colossians 2, 9 and 10, where it says Jesus is the fullness of the Godhead bodily, 1 Timothy 3, verse 16, where we learn that God was manifest in the flesh. We know these things, that Jesus was God. Okay, these three are one, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. But in John 10, when he came and ministered, he said some very hard things, and he said things about himself that only God could say. May I put on the table, that's not how you minister, okay? You don't say, I can forgive sins. You don't say, I can walk on water. I can do anything God can do. That's not our ministry. So again, when people talk about what we need to do do things the way Jesus did, we can't all the time because we're not him. In John 10, verse 33, the Jews answered Jesus, and Jesus asked them the question, for what works are you stoning me for? In verse 33, the Jews answered him, saying, for a good work we stone thee not, but for blasphemy, and because that thou, being a man, makes thyself God. Right? The Jews were right. If someone said they were God, that is blasphemy. Okay? That is wrong. They were exactly right. They just didn't believe Jesus was God. But it's a hard saying, isn't it? Here comes this one man, after thousands of years of human history, and he says, I'm God, God in the flesh. You know, it's only by faith, Matthew 16 says, that they could believe, and by the powers that they saw him do, right? But he was making some very bold claims, statements about himself. We can't say the things Jesus said about himself, him being God. Look at John chapter 5, verse 18. We see here again, when Jesus ministered, it wasn't that he was sugarcoating everything and trying to appeal to the largest number of people. He was saying things plainly, and some things are very hard, and people didn't get it. In fact, what he said turned people off. Halfway through his ministry, and by the way, you need to keep in your mind as well, Jesus' ministry was only a few years. This wasn't decades in ministry. Within a year and a half of his ministry, Jesus started to go to the cross, and he started talking about the destruction and doom of his own ministry. Very hard things. But in John 5, verse 18, you start talking like that today in ministry, people think you're a pessimist. Well, we've been doing this Grace Ambassadors thing for about 6 years, and we're probably going to die the next 2 or 3 years, so... That's just kind of a weird thing to do, isn't it? But that's what Jesus did. So this whole what would Jesus do question really is a strange question when you understand that Jesus came to minister to the circumcision to confirm the promises made to the fathers. He came to fulfill a purpose, which was die on the cross. That's something you don't do. You can't pattern yourself after the Lord from heaven. Now, you're conformed to his image, Romans chapter 8, in holiness and in righteousness. But you know what? Your better pattern of ministry would be the Apostle Paul, that God saved by his grace, and as a former sinner, sent him out to preach grace. That'd be a good place to look. Jesus never did that a day in his life in his earthly ministry. He preached the kingdom gospel. But in John 5, verse 18, here the Jews sought the more to kill him. Now, these Jews, they're just angry, wanting to kill the Lord, right? Why are they wanting to kill him? Because he's blaspheming in their eyes. Because he not only had broken the Sabbath, but it said also that God was his father, making himself equal with God. Right? So again, I'm God. Do you say that? I wouldn't say that. By the way, if you were born under the law program, would you be breaking the law? Jesus broke the Sabbath, it says here. Well, how did he break? Why did he break the Sabbath? Remember the story where he's eating the corn there on the Sabbath day and healing people on the Sabbath day? Jesus explains the intent of the law. But one of the reasons why Jesus does some of the things that he does is because he can. He's the Son of God. He says, I'm the Lord of the Sabbath, is what he says. You are not the Lord of the Sabbath, not to mention the Sabbath day isn't something that we need to follow today, but you're not the Lord of the Sabbath, right? So for Jesus to walk around saying, I'm the Lord of the Sabbath, that's a hard saying, right? That's something that only he could say, only he could do, and they wanted to kill him for it. He says in verse 19, he confirms the fact that I'm from the Father. John 3, the whole point of him saying that God gave his only begotten Son was not that God gave his Son on a cross. Jesus didn't say that in John 3:16. John 3, Jesus' point is that God sent me from heaven. God gave his Son from heaven to the earth. That's why he says he still loved the world. Right? Here I am, Jesus said. You know, worship me. Have faith in me. Believe in me. Those are hard things to say. Look at Mark chapter 2, verse 7. Mark chapter 2. Do you remember when Jesus was in the synagogue and he saw a lame or someone who needed healed there? I think it was their hand. And instead of healing them first, what he did is said, your sins are forgiven. Remember that? That caused an uproar. Why don't you just heal the guy? He already did that before. Mark 2, 7. There were scribes sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, why did this man thus speak blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God only? Jesus is forgiving people's sins. Now, I can't even forgive your sins. You can't forgive my sins. And these Jews are right to say nobody forgives sins but God. Well, they didn't know that Jesus was God. But you see the hard thing Jesus is doing here. This is not our pattern of ministry. This is not what we would do. In Matthew chapter 12, verse 8, let's see it here again. Where Jesus did some things only God can do because he was God. You cannot follow Jesus in baptism because Jesus had no sins to repent of. Okay? Not to mention the fact that you're not to be water baptized because your baptism is into Jesus' death, which was his second baptism. So water baptism does nothing for you, it being a Jewish ordinance. Matthew 12, verse 8, it says here, the Son of Man is the Lord even of the Sabbath day. So here they are, and they're eating corn, plucking ears of corn from the farmers, and they're going, hey, we need that to get our subsidy, you know. And he's going, wait a minute. He says, I'm the Lord of the Sabbath. All right. Well, you can't say that. Only the Lord could say that. He had that title. He's the Son of God. Only he could die on the cross. People say you need to take up your cross daily based on Luke 14. Jesus said you need to take up your cross or you can't follow me. He's not talking about a literal cross. He's not talking about you dying for your sins or paying for your sins. You can't do that. Only Christ could die on the cross for your sins because only he was God manifest in the flesh. Christianity is not about you suffering for your sins. And some people make it that. Okay? There are religions, and you include the Roman Catholic religion and some false thinking among the Protestants, that they will punish themselves in retribution for their own sins. And then when they do that, they're purging the sins away. Right? This is not true. That's where the idea of purgatory comes from. Is that when we all die, Christ's payment didn't pay for all your sins. When you die, you go to purgatory so you can pay it off the rest. Right? Through suffering. Right? Well, that's not the case. The Lord Jesus Christ is the only one that can pay for sins. You cannot if you wanted to. Because you are not God in the flesh. Okay? You're a human. Let's look at Mark chapter 9. So Jesus is kind of making it a little hard there in his ministry, isn't he? By saying that he's forgiven sins, deliberately provoking these scribes. He's saying that he's God. He's saying he can raise the temple in 3 days. Why doesn't he just appeal to the masses? He'd attract a lot more people if he just sought their opinion about why they didn't come to the temple. You know, that's what Christians do today. They go out and ask the atheists why they don't come to church. And they go, well, the atheist says this is what we're doing wrong. Let's change things. Why are we looking to them for the pattern? You know, and they say, well, I'm going to follow the Lord's ministry and his pattern. You know, he ate with the sinners. And they don't know the story that we read last week where Jesus ate with the sinners and called them out for their sins while he was eating with them. You know, they eat with the sinners and don't talk about sin. You know, it's fine. God loves you. He's tolerant. You know, there's a video floating around now. I'd recommend you watch it on YouTube about the nice little lady over in England who had a bed and breakfast that was closed down recently because some homosexuals over there were suing her and that sort of thing. And she doesn't allow unmarried couples to bed down in her house. And she was on television. And the dear soul there was asked the question, why are you taking these homosexuals to court for closing you down if your God is a tolerant God, a loving God? And wow, did she answer correctly? She goes, well, I think that's a myth. It's a myth that the God of the Bible is a loving and tolerant God. There's a lot of times in the Bible God is not tolerant at all. He's a long-suffering God, she says. She's patient, but he will judge sin. I was like, wow, on TV even. You know. But it wasn't from the reporter, it was from this other person, you know. So it's just interesting. You know, people don't realize what the Bible says, Jesus, how he acted, who he was, who God is. God is not tolerant of everybody saying all sins are okay, everyone's okay because I love you. No, he says that righteousness is what you need. You're the sinner, right? And Jesus came to call sinners to repent. That we learned last week in his earthly ministry to Israel. But meanwhile, where are we at here? We're in Matthew chapter 9. Jesus seems like he's making it hard for people. If he would just be more tolerant, then it seems he would have a greater following. But when he saw that the multitudes followed him, Jesus didn't like that because he knew their hearts and saw that they didn't follow him because they believed in him. They followed him because of the goodies he was providing. And so he started to speak in parables. He started to speak in things that they could not understand deliberately so that only the committed would stay. That's kind of tough, isn't it? I mean, don't you want to appeal to the babes? You know, let's help them out a little bit here. Matthew chapter 9, or we're in Mark 9, rather, is where I told you. Mm-hmm. Mark chapter 9, excuse me. Mark 9, 9 and 10. A lot of the amazing things that Jesus did in his ministry, he kept secret. Mark 9, 9, as they came down from the mountain. Now, if you read the previous 8 verses, you'll read this is the account of Jesus displaying his figure in kingdom glory to Peter, James, and John. Okay? Them alone. He brought them up to the mount, and there they see him talking with Elijah and Moses. And they hear the voice of God saying, this is my son. I mean, this is an amazing miracle. Testimony. This, I mean, what other evidence do you need that Jesus is the Son of God, that God would speak from heaven? You see him glorified, sees two dead people alive talking to him. I mean, this is amazing. And yet, verse 9 says, they came down from the mountain, he charged them that they should tell no man what things they had seen till the Son of Man were risen from the dead. What? People want to know that you're the Son of God. The Jews are asking him, telling us plainly, are you the Son of God or not? And here are these three men, and they go, we know that you are. We've seen it on the mountain. And he says, don't tell anybody this. I thought we were supposed to go tell it on the mountain, as the song says. They say, don't tell what happened on the mountain. You know, where do they get this? People want to minister like Jesus ministered. Well, he told his disciples, don't tell people the greatest evidence that you have that I'm the Son of God. Now, is that your pattern or not? I'm saying it's not your pattern. Jesus came to do a certain thing to Israel at a certain time in their history. The mystery of Christ had not been revealed. The gospel that saves you had not been revealed. The church wasn't even created yet. This is not your pattern. Okay? There's a reason why Jesus said, don't tell any man these things, because he had to die still. Right? The world could not receive him as king, yet it wasn't time. You see? And so we need to rightly divide, to discern the times, to understand what God is doing and when. If we think God's doing the same thing at all times, this is a very hard verse for people, because they're going, why wouldn't Jesus want them to tell this? They wrote a book about it later. They disobey God. God changes his instructions. That's the point. Look at Luke chapter 8, verse 51. Luke 8, 51. We read through these things, not considering sometimes how hard these things are that Jesus says. Luke 8, verse 51. In verse 49, there was a woman here who was having problems. She was dead. In verse 51, when he came into the house, he suffered no man to go in, save Peter and James and John and the father and the mother of the maiden. Now he's about to perform an amazing miracle. Resurrect this woman from the dead. Some commentators say she was only in a coma. Whatever. In verse 51, he was going to heal her. And instead of opening the windows and the doors saying, watch this, instead of carrying her out and then performing the healing, he does it in private. He kicks everyone else out of the house, Peter, James, and John only, and the father and the mother, and all wept and bewailed her. But he said, weep not, she is not dead, but sleeps. And they laughed him to scorn, knowing that she was dead. And he put them all out, and took her by the hand, and called, saying, maid, arise. And her spirit came again, and she arose straightway, and he commanded to give her meat. What an amazing miracle. Okay? He raises this woman. This is the only time, by the way, that Jesus raised someone from the dead. He would walk down the street and see someone carrying a funeral procession, and suddenly, snap his fingers, here comes the coffin opening up. You know, that'll ruin your funeral day when someone does that. Resurrection of the dead. But in verse 56, her parents were astonished, but he charged them that they should not tell no man what was done. Why? Why did Jesus do this? This is such a hard thing. How can you keep that quiet? You raised my daughter from the dead. She's going to walk out tomorrow. They're going to see this. But he didn't want them to tell them. He didn't want them to publish this. Look at Matthew chapter 9, verse 27. We see here two blind men. Now these people don't even listen to Jesus. Jesus tells them what to do, and they don't listen to him. They disobey him. Matthew 9, verse 27, when Jesus departed thence, two blind men followed him, crying and saying, thou son of David, have mercy on us. When he was come into the house, the blind men came to him, and Jesus saith unto them, believe ye that I am able to do this? They said unto him, yea, Lord. Then touched he their eyes, saying, according to your faith be it unto you. And their eyes were opened, and Jesus straightly charged them, saying, see that no man know it. But they, when they were departed, spread abroad his fame in all that country. We covered 2 weeks ago, Jesus was famous because of the miracles that he did. Okay, but only some of the miracles Jesus did in public. John says if we recorded everything Jesus did, the books couldn't contain it in John 20, 32. Right? There's a lot of times in the recorded history of what Jesus did that Jesus told people not to tell anybody. Okay, and there's a reason for that in his ministry. It's because he didn't want everybody to know. Okay? And this, again, is a hard saying that people don't know what to deal with, but it's not your pattern of ministry the way you look at it. Look at Matthew 16. Jesus did not want people to know some things in Matthew 16, 20. Matthew 16 is the famous passage where he asks his disciples, who do men say that I am? You know, and Peter is the one who responds with the correct answer because the Lord revealed it to him, that you are the Son of God, you are the very Christ. Right? You're the Son of the living God, Matthew 16, 16. Jesus called him blessed in verse 17. He gives him the keys to the kingdom in verse 19. Then in verse 20, he charges his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ. Now, I thought that the gospel, as taught by churches all over the country, was this right here. Okay? It was the gospel of his name, the gospel of Jesus is the Christ. If you just know who Jesus is, he's the Christ. And he's telling his disciples, don't tell any man that he is the Christ. Now, Jesus did that for the first year and a half, 2 years of his ministry. He was trying to prove to people he was the Christ. But at this point in his ministry, when he realized he's being rejected, the king's being rejected, he's going to the cross and he's saying, I'm changing what I'm doing here. We're no longer ministering that. I'm no longer ministering the kingdom's come. They're going to kill me. They have to kill me. And I'll tell you what we do after that. Okay, there was a slight change in Jesus' ministry, and it's not our pattern at all, telling no man that he was Jesus the Christ. That is the very base of our ministry, telling Jesus that he was the Christ and that he died for your sins and resurrected. That's what we do. So are you disobedient to Matthew 16, verse 20? You see the need then to rightly divide what God's doing and why some things Jesus did you don't need to do? It's important. Okay, Matthew 16, 21, from that time forth, which means this is the first time he said it, began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go to Jerusalem, suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, be raised again the third day. So he's talking about his death now. A very hard thing when someone talks about their own death. You kind of want to encourage them, especially these disciples, Peter being the prominent one here, who wants to say, they're not going to kill you. We're not going to let that happen. We'll fight to the death for you, Lord. And no doubt he would have. But that wasn't what Jesus said you needed to do at that time. And so he calls him the devil and says, get thee away from me, right, in verse 23. From that point on, every time Jesus mentioned his death, his disciples were afraid to ask him about it. They didn't understand it, and they were like, I'm not going to talk to him. Because last time he called Peter the devil, and that was a hard saying, you know, very stern. But look at Mark 9:32, and you'll see what I'm talking about, where Mark 9 tells another case. Of course, it was after Matthew 16, because Matthew 16 was the first time. But Mark 9, verse 32, 31, it says, he taught his disciples and said unto them, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of men, and they shall kill him. And after that he is killed, he shall rise the third day. And so he's telling the event that ought to happen, that will eventually be made known to save the soul of any man who trusts in it for their salvation, according to the gospel of grace. But he was not teaching it as the gospel here. Nobody he ministered to understood the preaching of the cross. And the very next verse says, his own disciples did not understand. They understood not that saying, and were afraid to ask him. Just don't ask him about his death. He keeps talking about that. Just don't ask him about it. Okay? Hard sayings. So we're seeing here Jesus' earthly ministry, turbulent times here. His disciples quite often just don't get what he's doing. Now later it will be revealed a little bit more, but that shows you that Jesus is not the pattern of ministry today. What he did was for a specific purpose. We learned from Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John who he was in the flesh. We learned from Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John the miracles that he did, without which, how can we prove that he was the Son of God? We learned from Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John that he died and resurrected, by whose hands he died, he was crucified. Okay? We learned the truth of those events. We learned that Jesus was God manifest in the flesh. But we don't learn anything about the gospel that saves us today because it wasn't revealed until later. Okay, and that's what we take away here. Look at Luke chapter 2, verse 49. Luke 2, 49. Many times in Jesus' ministry, you say, well, he called the children unto him. No doubt he was giving some children's lessons and making crafts and everything else. What a good husband. Luke 2, verse 49. You ever heard women who called Jesus their husband? Married to Jesus, they say. Gives me the willies. But Luke chapter 2, verse 49. So it's weird when they say that. What do they mean? They can't get a date. I don't know. But there's lots of men out there, ladies. I'm not getting off track. Luke 2, verse 49. He is your Lord. He is your Savior. You praise him for that. Luke 2, 49. Here's when he's young. Okay? And so he's in the temple. This is the place where he's in there talking with the scribes and the priests, and Mary and Joseph, they leave, not knowing that he wasn't there, and they come back all worried. And in verse 48, his mother said to him, Son, why hast thou thus dealt with us? Behold, thy father and I have sought thee sorrowing. We were traveling down the road, and you weren't with us. And he said unto them, how is it that ye sought me? Wist ye not, didn't you know, that I must be about my father's business? So this is the first time we read in Matthew, Luke, and John that he refers to his own father as God. Okay, and this is when he was 12 years old. And verse 50 says, they understood not the saying which he spake unto them. Now, don't you think Jesus should have sat down and like, listen, Mary, let me explain this to you. But he didn't. He just said it. And they didn't understand. They were left without understanding. Lots of times when Jesus spoke in his earthly ministry, they didn't understand. People didn't understand. Look at Luke 18, 34. Well, you don't have to look there because you know what it's going to say. Because it's the same. It's a similar account as Mark 9 and Matthew 16. When he tells his disciples about his death, and it says that they understood none of these things, the saying was hid from them, neither knew they the things which were spoken. Jesus spoke to his disciples, and they did not know. So people today, they read Jesus' parables, they read Jesus' messages, and they try to explain them to you. Well, you're doing more than Jesus did. You say, I'm not saying it's wrong to understand the Bible, I'm saying Jesus didn't do that. Okay, and the Bible says he didn't do that, because they didn't understand what he said. Right? So there was very hard things that Jesus said. It's a good thing that he later opened their eyes, and it's a good thing that today God has revealed the manifold wisdom of his will so that we can understand. You know, one of our primary goals here as we study the Bible is that we understand what the Bible says. It wasn't always the goal of God's people for that to happen. It was not the goal of Israel that everybody understand every jot and tittle and contortion of the law. They were to know the law, put it in their hearts, right? But, you know, they were to live their lives for the Lord. They were supposed to be good Jews, good God's representatives, right? That was their instruction. They were supposed to offer the sacrifices. If they didn't know about the law, they go to the priest, ask them about the law. They're students of the law, right? But today, every one of us is accountable to understand God's will, to understand the Bible, right? We're not under the law, thank goodness. We don't have to know all the ins and outs that the priest had to know, yet we should learn the lesson of the law that teaches the knowledge of sin, right? And so we learn these things. So it's a very different orientation. When Jesus came, they didn't have to understand everything he said. They had to know the law and the prophets, though. But moving on here, let's look at John 8, 27. Jesus talks here in John 8, and they didn't understand what he said. And instead of explaining it, Jesus just moves on. John 8, 27. John 8, 26. Jesus says, I have many things to say and to judge of you, but he that sent me is true, and I speak to the world those things which I have heard of him. I'm going to read that again. Because if you just hear that the first time, I don't know if any of you are going, what? But it's kind of hard to understand. I have many things to say and to judge of you, to which I would respond, Lord, what is it? What's on your mind? Tell me. Right? But he didn't. John 17, later in the book, he says, there's many things I have to tell you, but you can't bear them now. Oh, come on! Why'd you tell me that? John 8, 26, though, he says, he that sent me is true, and I speak to the world those things which I have heard of him. They understood not that he spake to them of the Father. They didn't understand what he said. We can read the book of John now and know what he said because verse 27 is there. He spake to them of the Father. The Father sent him. But when Jesus said it, did they know it? No one knew. Okay. So you imagine the confusion that is around Jesus' ministry, right? And you thought that everywhere he went, he was just opening up doors of understanding. A little quibble, little saying, all of a sudden, life has meaning, you know. He's walking around, he's confusing people. All right? This was part of Jesus' aura. Now, I'm not saying the Bible is confusing or God is the author of confusion. That is not true. I'm saying when Jesus ministered to Israel, the circumcision, there were things that he said that left people baffled. Okay? Look at John 12:15. Our duty today is not to die on the cross. Our duty today is not to go to Israel to teach them the law. Our duty today is not to make students of the law, like Matthew 28 says. Our responsibility today is to communicate the gospel of the grace of God. That requires of us that we not only understand it, that we clearly communicate it so that people can understand it. Okay? If we were to hide that from people, that's patterning ourselves after the God of this world that hides the gospel from people's eyes and condemns them to be unsaved. Okay, we make it clear. So I'm just trying to present the difference here between how Jesus ministered to Israel and how he's told us to minister. John 12:15. Fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, thy king cometh, sitting on an ass's colt. You know the story where he's got the donkey there, he's on the ass, and he walks into Jerusalem, or he rides into Jerusalem, and they got the palm trees, Hosanna, and this sort of thing. Right? When he makes this statement, when he had found a young ass, he sat there on and says, Fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, thy king comes. Sing on an ass's colt. His disciples go, That's crazy. Jesus again. Don't know what he said. These things understood not his disciples at the first. Sometimes he just says things that are hard to understand. But when Jesus was glorified, then remembered they that these things were written of him, that they had done these things unto him. You know why I think they remembered these things? Because Jesus said in John 15 that when I leave, I'll give you the Comforter. I'll give you the Spirit of Truth. And he will bring into remembrance the things that I said unto you. He will teach you things you don't know now, which is according to the New Covenant. So here's Jesus just uttering these things because Jesus had to fulfill all the prophecies. And people around him going, what was that? Like he's talking to a TV screen. You know, what? Who are you talking to? That's his cult. What are you talking about? But then later they remember, they wrote it down and said, look, that's proof he was the Son of God. He did what was necessary to fulfill the prophecies. Okay? Look at John 6:60. This is one of the most popular places in Jesus' ministry where he stuck to his guns, you know? Jesus said something hard, he didn't budge, and he lost half the people in his ministry because of it. Why didn't he just explain that it's not talking about Roman Catholic Mass? But he didn't. In John chapter 6, when Jesus talks about himself being the bread of life, and how your fathers ate manna in the desert, but I'm telling you, you should eat me. What? Come again? Eat my blood, eat my flesh. A little more, please. Eat me, and you'll live. This is his message. Read John 6, and that's what he says. And down in verse 60, he says, many therefore of his disciples, when they had heard this, said, this is a hard saying. Who can hear it? His own disciples. We need to be like Jesus. What would Jesus do? You know, this doesn't really fall into the ministry pattern that people learn in seminary. You know, go to the sinner, comfort the sick, you know, tell them nice words, tell them what would occur, you know, help people. Jesus would help people. Well, why doesn't he help them understand? Because he doesn't. Verse 61, when Jesus knew in himself that his own disciples murmured at it, he said unto them, doth this offend you? One, if ye live, shall see the Son of Man ascend up where he was before. If you see me ascend to heaven, will you then eat me? We just don't get it, Lord. We don't get it. He says in verse 63, it is the spirit that quickens. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit, they are life. So he explains here a little bit, which is the answer, by the way, when the Roman Catholics say that we need to eat Jesus' actual flesh, and that's why we have the mass that turns into cells that you eat. And we have wine that turns into blood that you drink. And that's nonsense, because Jesus says it's not the flesh, it's the spirit that quickens. Okay, it's the words that he says. In verse 64, he says, there are some of you that believe not, for Jesus knew from the beginning who they were that believed not, and who should betray him. And he said, therefore said unto you, that no man can come unto me except it were given unto him of the Father. From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. If Jesus just would have put it in a little more palatable package, they possibly would not have left him. But he did these things intentionally, because he knew there were those that didn't believe, and he spoke certain things that were hard, so those who did not believe would leave. Right? Now, I don't pattern myself after the way Jesus ministered to Israel, and yet there are times when that happens here. Okay? Sometimes new people come in, and I've told you before, this is not the place to bring brand new people on a Sunday morning or on a Tuesday, you know, sometimes, because they're totally blank. You aren't the Bible rightly divided? And they hear me say something about Jesus and me not following, they're going to run out the door, right? They're not going to understand that. We need to be ministering to people outside these walls and teaching the gospel. We meet here to fellowship with each other, to encourage each other, to edify one another, so we're able to go out and minister. That's another lesson for another day. Jesus here saying these very hard sayings about eating him. Look at Matthew 13. One final point about hard sayings Jesus said to Israel is in Matthew 13, where he says very deliberately that he's trying to confuse them so they would not be saved. Again, I told you before, this is not a complete picture of everything Jesus said. This is just the other side of the story. This is the rest of the story, as Paul Harvey used to say, right? This is an accurate biblical description of what Jesus did oftentimes. Look at Matthew 13:9. And we don't have the right, by the way, to take our Bible and rip out half of the verses because we don't agree with them. We have to take all of them, right? Matthew 13, verse 9. Jesus gets done telling the first parable, which is the parable of the sower. You may be familiar with it, where there's the four grounds and the planting of the seed, and there's different types of ground, and based on the ground, the seed grows or doesn't grow. When I say that parable to you, you automatically know, in essence, what Jesus was talking about, because it's been taught in so many spiritual lessons about people receiving the gospel or not. But the first time Jesus said it, no one understood what he was talking about. He was talking about farming. But in Matthew 13, verse 9, he said, who hath ears to hear, let him hear. And he left. Thank you for coming. Passed the plate, and he left. Okay? There's no explanation to the crowd here what he was talking about. His disciples came to him, and they said unto him, why speakest thou unto them in parables? Now, you go to seminary, and they will tell you that the parables were spoken by Jesus so that people could better understand his teachings. And yet, that's not what you read about in Matthew 13, verse 10. Parables were, yes, they were stories, they were analogies in order to illustrate something, and yet parables were like more like riddles, in that they had the intent purpose to hide some information. If he wasn't trying to hide it, he would have said to the masses what he says here to his disciples, which is the explanation of the parable. Okay, but he speaks to them in parables, and the disciples say, why are you speaking to them in parables? They can't understand these things. And like I said, Jesus came in his ministry to fulfill the prophecies. And so in Psalm 78, when it says, I come to speak to them in parables, that's why Jesus came to speak in parables. Okay, some dark sayings is what Psalm 78 says. He came and revealed some hard things. But Jesus answers and said unto them, because I speak to them in parables, because it is given unto you, disciples, to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. But to them it is not given. Well, who is Jesus to know whose it's given to and even not to? Well, he's the Lord. And he knows their hearts. He knows they don't believe. And those who believe came and asked him. But those who didn't believe, they just said, oh, all right. Don't agree with that guy. It's a hard saying. Okay. Matthew 13, verse 12. For whosoever hath, to him shall be given, and he shall have more abundance. But whosoever hath not, from him shall be taken away, even that he hath. He's talking here about the faithful remnant of Israel, and how he's ministering to Israel about the kingdom, which is what all of his parables were about. And he's talking about the remnant of Israel, his disciples, who by faith believe he's the Messiah. And he says, if you have faith, you'll be given more in the kingdom. Right? If you don't have faith, what you have, which is status as Israel, will be taken away. If you don't have faith in me, you won't even enter the kingdom, no matter you're circumcised, no matter you're a son of Abraham. Matthew 13, though, he says in verse 13, therefore speak I to them in parables, because they, seeing, see not, and hearing, they hear not, neither do they understand. And he quotes Isaiah 6:9, where God told Isaiah to go minister to Israel so that they would be confused. That's what Isaiah 6:9-10 says. And Jesus says, this is what I'm doing. I'm speaking to Israel so they would be confused. And only those who had faith in me would understand. And in verse 14, in them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah, which saith, by hearing ye shall hear, and shall not understand, and seeing ye shall see, and shall not perceive. For this people's heart is waxed gross, their ears are dull of hearing, and their eyes they have closed, lest at any time they should see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and should understand with their heart, and should be converted, and I should heal them. Didn't Jesus just say, he speaks in parables, that people would not be healed and converted? That's exactly what he just said. Now, he says that judging these people and their gross wax ears is what he says. They don't hear, they don't understand, they don't see, so I'm going to take away from them. They won't be able to hear and see. Some people minister like this today. They'll minister the gospel to some person, and if they reject him the first time, they'll say, well, I'm not giving it to you. Kick the dust off my feet. You're condemned to hell. Right? We live in the dispensation of the gospel, the grace of God. We minister the gospel. We do not judge people to hell. God does that. We do not tell people that they can't understand it at all because their ears have been closed. We minister the gospel. They don't believe it, we minister it again. We minister it again. We minister it again. We do it until the Lord come. We minister the gospel. We never quit. There was a time where Jesus said, these people don't get it. I'm not going to give it to them anymore. Okay? That's because he was ministering the kingdom to these people. And what he was ministering was the kingdom, not salvation from the cross. And there was a time where Jesus said, you're not going to get the kingdom. These people are. He was the king. Okay? His ministry was different. How he ministered was different than how we minister because of his message. The parables were spoken so that people would not hear and understand. Not so that they would. Now you go back now and read Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and you can understand some of the parables because Jesus explained them to his disciples. That's a cheat sheet, folks. When he said them the first time, people around him didn't understand them. And that was on purpose when he said that. Look at Matthew 5. Since you're in Matthew. Now, we've covered the last 25 minutes, hard sayings for Israel at the time that Jesus said them. Sometimes people don't realize that when Jesus said those things, they couldn't understand them. Now we're going to cover a few things that were hard sayings, not just for Israel, but when the church tries to apply them wrongly to themselves, they're hard for the church. In fact, they're so hard that the church doesn't even teach these things, and they don't teach them literally, because otherwise they'd be doing some very strange things. Okay? Now, we know in Romans 15, verse 8, Paul says Jesus Christ was the minister of the circumcision, to confirm the truth of the fathers, and we are not to pattern our ministry after Jesus' ministry. He did not come to the church, to the Gentiles. Okay, he came to Israel. And we know that the gospel that saves us wasn't found in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So there's lots of reasons why the church shouldn't go back here. And yet the church does, and they go back to the red letters. And if you look at Matthew 5, 17 and 18, you read here what Jesus said about the law. When Jesus talked, when he said things, when he ministered, he taught the law like a legalist. Christians today love to discourage people by saying you're a legalist because you want to control people's lives by the law you're putting on them, right? Typically people oriented around grace. there are those Christians who will be proud in their legalism and say, well, we should put the law on people because if you don't live right, then God has no reason to save. Those people, I put a giant question mark on whether they're saved or not, because they don't understand the gospel of God's grace and the preaching of the cross. Matthew 5:17, this is where they get such teaching, because Jesus said that. Jesus was a legalist. He taught the law that way. But we're not judgmental. Jesus wasn't judgmental. He judged by the law. Think not I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy the law, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments, there's 613 in Israel's law, if you break the least, I see a lot of you men out there don't have tassels on your garments. I see a lot of you have shaved this morning. This is wrong. You see, those are just the small laws. Jesus said the least of the commandments. Right? Well, then you had to make up some theology now that Jesus changed the law, and the only law you gotta follow now is love God with all your heart, mind, and soul. Which was one of the 613. Plus, and analyze that. Did you love God with all your heart, mind, and soul today? Every moment, every second of your life, you love God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul. Or is it you fall short of the glory of God? Right? Matthew 5, verse 19, Jesus is a legalist. Because, Galatians 4, he was born under the law. Jesus was a Jewish minister to Israel, ministering the covenants and the kingdom of the law. Okay? That's a hard saying for people who want to teach grace today. That's not grace. Matthew 5, verse 19. He says, whoever shall break one of these least commandments, and who shall teach men so, he shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. You see the threat there, right? So how do you become greatest in the kingdom of heaven? You teach people, according to Matthew 5:19, to keep every law, even the small ones, right? So when you hear those legalist folks out there and say, you know, if you enter into a movie house, you know, you're not going to enter in. You're in danger, hellfire, you know, whatever it is that they say. You know, it's obvious legalism. People point this out, it's legalism, right? But the people who preach that have a pattern. And their pattern is Jesus, Matthew 5, verse 19. All I'm saying is we need to rightly divide that. Yes, that's what Jesus did. But we need to rightly divide that from the dispensation of grace. Because our pattern is not Jesus to Israel. The rest of the church has no pattern. They think grace is a license to do whatever we want. That's not true either, you see. But you see Jesus being a legalist here. Look at John 14:15. Well, I'll just quote it to you. Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. John 14, verse 15. Okay, if you don't love me, if you don't keep my commandments, then you don't love me, and the love of the Father doesn't abide in you, is what he said. Okay, I was talking to Phil this morning. He quoted me 1 John, where it talks about if you keep commandments, you'll be saved. Right? So 1 John teaches. How do you get around that? That's legalism. And John says, I don't teach you a new commandment. It's an old commandment. It's as old as Moses. Jesus taught it. Moses taught it. And you got to do the commandments. It's legalism. Okay? Matthew 25, verse 45. Jesus didn't judge people. What about the adulterous woman? He didn't stone her. Okay? One gentleman brought this up to me. He says, well, Jesus was forgiving. He didn't judge according to the law because the adulterous woman was brought before him. He said, he without sin cast the first stone. You know what was the genius of what Jesus said there was that he kept the law perfectly. That's what it was. He did not void the law at all. He said, fine, stone her. If it be true that you caught her in the act, and there were more than two witnesses, which apparently there was a crowd there, and they claimed to have caught her in the act, he said, fine, if it be true, she's guilty of adultery, worthy of stoning, then he without sin cast the first stone. That's all he said. He said, let's carry out the sentence. And they couldn't because of what he said about their own sin. That's a good judge. That's a merciful judge. A merciful judge is a judge that counts you guilty and then says, you know, I would be merciful on the sentence. The law is upheld, folks. Just because a judge gives mercy doesn't mean he gets rid of it. Okay, but Matthew 20, we're in Matthew 25, down verse 45. These two verses here are the foundation for so many charities in our country, and people think that by doing things to the least of these, they will be earning for themselves a position in heaven. Okay? So there's doctrinal problems here, but Jesus taught this very thing when he answers and says, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as you did it, meaning you gave food to the hungry or water to the thirsty or Social Security paychecks to the old people, then, you know, then, that's what Senator Rangel said a couple weeks ago to hear that. That if anyone knows their Bible, they know that if we don't give food stamps and Social Security and welfare, then Verse 46, you're going to hell, which is what the Democratic senator said. You're going to hell if you don't vote for Social Security. And he gets it from Matthew 25, 46. These shall go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous unto life eternal. Jesus is talking about hell. And he's talking about giving water to people who are thirsty. So your eternal life now depends upon whether or not you give water to thirsty people? I vote for Social Security. I vote for welfare. I vote for all of it. Let's not miss a soul. Because I want eternal life. Right? The doctrine is different here. But the point I'm trying to make is Jesus is a legalist. He's teaching works, isn't he? No mention that the brethren here are Israel and not every poor person in the world. Not to mention it has to do with the covenant. But meanwhile, he's talking about everlasting punishment. Wow, that's a hard thing. Matthew 19, 17, he talks to the rich young ruler about entering into life by keeping the commandments. Matthew 19, 17. Very good tactic to show someone the hard saying of Jesus regarding the gospel, Matthew 19, 17. When you show them that Jesus' response to the question of how do I inherit eternal life was do the commandments. Okay? You'll know you're talking to a legalist, let's go. When they respond with the answer, so what? That's what we ought to do. Now you're dealing with a legalist. They need to show their own sin by using the law to show that they can't do it. But if you're talking to someone who realizes their own sin, you show them that the gospel Jesus taught was keeping the commandments for life, hopefully they'll get the idea that the gospel Jesus was teaching to Israel is not the gospel Jesus told us to teach. Okay? But you've heard that before. Matthew chapter 8, verse 4, Jesus tells someone he heals to go offer a sacrifice, offer a gift in the temple. Jesus didn't come to destroy the temple. He said, do what they teach in there. They teach the law, do it. He heals the guy and says, see thou tell no man, we covered that before, but go thy way, show thyself to the priest, tell him, and offer the gift that Moses commanded for a testimony unto them. Jesus taught the law of Moses. That's not really a bookmark verse. You don't see that in a lot of bookmarks, is what I mean. You go to Christian bookstores, you see little pictures with lambs and stuff on them with verses. You don't see Matthew 8, verse 4 on it. Go to the priest, offer the gift Moses commanded. In Matthew chapter 23, verse 2 and 3, Jesus tells his disciples to do that which those who sit in Moses' seat tell you to do. Just don't do after their hypocrisy. But when they teach you the law, do it. Right? Because that's what they ought to do. Matthew 28 in the Great Commission says the same thing. Go and teach the nations the commandments, is what it says to do. Baptizing them. Teaching them the commandments, Matthew 28. Okay. Matthew 23, 23, Jesus tells the Pharisees there that they tithe. But they omitted the weightier matters in the law. They should have done everything in the law. The love, the righteousness, the judgment, and the tithing, and the sacrifices. Jesus didn't come to destroy the law. So why is all this stuff about the New Testament getting rid of the sacrifices and all this business? That's another question we need to ask. Okay? Jesus said some hard things. Luke chapter 18. Luke 18, 22. Jesus told people to sell everything they had. Jesus was more Francis Chan than Francis Chan. I don't know if you know who Francis Chan is. Some folks nowadays think it's a hip thing to do to be radical in your faith and to sell everything you have and commit your life to the Lord, and that's how you do that, right? And they end up with nothing. Fortunately, they have book deals and speaker engagements. They're able to get more money. But Jesus said to sell everything you got, okay? And he would provide. In Luke 18, 22, he says, now when Jesus heard these things, he said unto him, this is the ruler who asked him, well, how do I have eternal life? And he said, keep the commandments in verse 20. And the guy said, I did that, verse 21. Verse 22 then, Jesus says, great. He says, yet lackest thou one thing. Sell all that thou hast and distribute unto the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven. Come follow me. So he's got to sell, he's got to distribute, and he's got to follow Jesus. Okay? You can't follow him. We've already covered that. He's gone. So you can't do the follow him part. But if you sold everything you had and distributed to the poor, that would change the economics in society, wouldn't it? Some people take any verse in the Bible they can and twist it for their own means. Except for church people. They don't do that. But yeah, they do. They just don't take this one. People teach this most often in saying, well, you have to be willing to do that. Well, then why did the disciples actually do it? Matthew 19, Peter said, I gave up everything. I had a fishing career. Right? In Acts chapter 4, they sold their houses and put them at the feet of the apostles. They had all things in common because Jesus instructed them to do that. And when the dispensation changed, they were all poor. So much so that Paul, when he was given the new dispensation of grace from the Lord, the new operation where God said, you know what, I'm not giving your daily bread anymore. You need to work with your own hands for your own bread. And Paul says, oh, that means those guys are poor in Jerusalem. And he takes a collection from the saints among the Gentiles and gives it to the poor saints in Jerusalem, Romans 15. Okay. If you do that today, if you follow Jesus' pattern in Luke 18, you'll be poor. I mean, you'll be distributing to the poor and make yourself poor. People call that piety because they think that's what's going to earn you a spot in heaven. Well, if you're talking about Jesus' ministry to Israel and the kingdom of heaven, that's true. If you're talking about the dispensation of grace and the body of Christ and the gospel that saves today, not true at all. Okay? And so what Jesus said was a hard thing. It's a hard thing for church people to follow, and they don't do it. Luke 14 is where Jesus says to take up your cross, and if you can't be a disciple of him, he says, unless you hate your father and mother. This has caused people consternation for quite a while. Man, the commitment that he's requiring here. There went a great multitude with him, and he turned and said unto the multitudes, if any man come to me and hate not his father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yea, and his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. So you got people talking about bearing your cross. That's what it means to be a Christian. And so people will try to push you into more and more commitment. Rededicate your life. You know, you need to give more and more and more, because unless you get to this point, where people hate you because of your stand for the truth, you're not doing right. And if people don't hate you because of your stand for the truth, people aren't against you for your stand for the truth, you're probably not saved. That's people teach it. It's just wrong. Well, it says here, Jesus says, you can't be my disciple unless you do. That's because he was a king bringing in a kingdom to Israel. And he was saying, if you follow me with your feet, I will lead you into the literal kingdom. You don't need your money and stuff, because there's going to be tribulation coming down from heaven. I'll provide your food miraculously. And unless you forego your future plans, unless you forego your current existence and follow me literally, you can't be my disciple. Right? Because you'll be like the rich guy who says, well, I've got a lot of savings. You'll be like the rich guy, you know, who went back because he had much. Right, so Jesus' pattern here is not, again, our pattern. Jesus taught hellfire and punishment. People say we shouldn't talk about hell. Hell is a very disturbing concept for people, and the church doesn't talk about it very much, but Jesus taught it. Jesus spoke a lot more about hell than he did about heaven, actually. But in Mark 9, he mentions it three times. It's better to go into life without hands and arms than to go into hell with your whole body. He's talking about hell. In Matthew 13, 40 and 42, he talks about hellfire and judgment. What would Jesus do? Matthew 13, verse 40. As therefore the tares are gathered and burnt in the fire, so shall it be in the end of this world. The Son of Man shall send forth his angels. They shall gather out of his kingdom all things that offend, and them which do iniquity, and shall cast them into a furnace of fire. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Fire, gnashing of teeth. Jesus spoke plainly about these things. That's not what people think about when they go back to the red letters to try to pattern themselves after Jesus. He was a nice guy. Remember Jesus, gentle, meek, and mild? He's not going to offend anybody. Then why is he talking about hell? Because the moment you talk about hell and God burning up those who do iniquity, you're going to offend somebody. Because we're all sinners, right? Now again, I'm not saying that what Jesus ministered here was what we ministered, because we're not living in the end of the world as Jesus talks about here. We're living in the dispensation of grace where God's offering peace and salvation to all. And yet, there is literal hell, and we'll be wailing and gnashing of teeth, apparently, when the judgment comes. And we're trying to save people from that. Matthew 13, 47. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a net that was cast into the sea and gathered of every kind, which when it was full, they drew to shore and sat down and gathered the good into vessels, but cast the bad away. So shall it be at the end of the world. The angels shall come forth and sever the wicked from among the just, and shall cast them into the furnace of fire. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. And Jesus' popularity goes down a few points. You know, hard sayings, the Lord said. Matthew 24, 32, Jesus teaches the end times like Harold Camping. And we in the church today, we bring them up at our 10 o'clock and sometimes dissect them about how they're wrong and they don't really divide. And yet a lot of the things that people do wrong today was exactly what Jesus did in his earthly ministry. And that's the problem. They don't rightly divide that. Okay. But Matthew 24, Jesus lists the whole book better than Hal Lindsey did about the signs of the times. Right? About what going to happen, how you need to watch and look for these things. And yet, Matthew 24 is not talking about the times in which we live. So it's different. Matthew 24, 32, learn the parable of the fig tree. When his branch is yet tender and puts forth leaves, ye know that summer is nigh. So likewise ye, when ye shall see all these things, know that it is near, even at the doors. Right? parable of the fig tree. And everyone tries to figure out this fig tree. Do you know the fig tree has to do with Israel, and it's something talked about over and over again in prophecy? We dealt with the olive tree in Romans 11. It's a prophetic thing. It has not to do with the dispensation of the mystery, which is the church. So we're not looking for the signs of the times, Matthew 24. By the way, the one sign that Jesus gives in Matthew 24 is that he will be seen from east to west. So you don't have to guess. You'll see it as lightning. But you won't be here, of course. The church reveals, the dispensation of grace reveals to you that you'll be raised up in the air to meet the Lord there. He taught separation between Jew and Gentile. Matthew 10, verse 5, Jesus told his disciples not to go to the Gentiles. Matthew 15, 26, he tells the Canaanite woman she's a dog because she's a Gentile. In John 4, 22, he tells the Samaritan woman that salvation is of the Jews. Right? A little racial superior, aren't you there, Jesus? I thought you came to all men. Right? Because he understood that God made a covenant with Israel. And it was a difference. But when he revealed to Paul the mystery, it was with Paul first that he taught there was no difference. There's Jew and Gentile can both be part of the body of Christ. We have access to God by faith in the bloodshed of Jesus Christ, not through a covenant, not because God chose Israel. So you see, there's lots of hard sayings that Jesus said in his ministry, hard sayings for Israel that now we can explain, but also hard sayings for the church who claims to be following Jesus. Well, they don't do these things because they're so hard. But our pattern is not Jesus' earthly ministry. Our pattern is what God presented to the Apostle Paul in 1 Timothy 1:15, which is his salvation is long-suffering by grace. Paul presents himself as a pattern to them which should hereafter believe. Okay, Paul does not keep secrets. Now, I'm not here putting Paul against Jesus. I'm talking about Jesus to Israel and Jesus to Paul. But Jesus told Paul not to keep secrets. He told him to reveal the secrets, the mysteries. Romans 16, 25, Paul says the preaching of Jesus Christ, which was kept secret, he now teaches. Acts 20, 27, Paul says, I did not shun to declare unto you the whole counsel of God. I haven't kept anything back. Jesus to Israel said, there's some things I'm not going to tell you. Don't tell people this. Paul says, he's made known unto us his manifold wisdom. We're to make all men see the fellowship of the mystery. That's the difference in our ministry that the Lord's given us. Ephesians 1, 9 says, God has made known the mystery of his will. Ephesians 3:10, it says that we have the manifold wisdom of God that we're to make all men see, right? We're to preach this stuff, to make it known. Romans 4:5 says, but to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. You know what that means? Salvation is simple. It's not a hard saying at all. Okay, what's hard is that people want to present their own works. There are no works involved on your behalf for salvation. Christ did all the work. You have nothing to bring to the table except for your sin. And so our message is simple. You can't do anything. God did everything through Jesus Christ for your salvation on the cross. Right? It's simple because there's no works. There's no law. If there are works and a law, if there are things you have to do, we'd have to list them all and then explain them all. Then you have to do them all. That's hard. Jesus said, you love me, keep my commandments. Paul says that God committed his love toward us, that while we were sinners, Christ died for us, and we're saved by grace through faith in that. Okay, the Lord made our ministry simple and easy to understand, but when Jesus ministered to Israel, there were some things hard to understand. They didn't realize. So Jesus would not be our pattern for ministry today. Okay. So don't be discouraged when you talk about the Bible rightly divided and talk about some things that other people find hard to understand. They're still operating with a Bible that's not discerned. They don't know how to use it. Okay. We need to help people understand how to rightly divide. Any questions? Any thoughts?